الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Once again, بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. My brothers and sisters, many of us don't thank Allah for what He has bestowed upon us. Sulaiman alayhi salam, who was granted so much by Allah, he calls out to Allah saying, "Oh Allah, give me the ability to be thankful to you." Subhanallah. Look at the calmness and contentment that brings to the heart when you say, "Oh my Lord, grant me the ability to be thankful." One is to be thankful, but before that, know that it is only Allah who can give you the ability to be thankful to Him. So we are asking Allah to grant us that beautiful ability. Verse number 19 of Surah An-Naml, Sulaiman alayhi salam, after making mention of how he spoke to the ants and how he cared for the ants and that he didn't want to trample the ants, subhanallah, today we trample over human beings in the name of Allah. Sulaiman alayhi salam didn't even trample over the ants. And they were just small, insignificant creatures, sometimes considered a pest. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. He says,
رَبِّ أَوْزِعْنِي أَنْ أَشْكُرَ نِعْمَتَكَ الَّتِي أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيَّ وَعَلَى وَالِدَيَّ وَأَنْ أَعْمَلَ صَالِحًا تَرْضَاهُ وَأَدْخِلْنِي بِرَحْمَتِكَ فِي عِبَادِكَ الصَّالِحِينَ.
Oh my Lord, give me the ability to be thankful to you. To be thankful to you about the favors that you have bestowed upon me and my parents. And to do good deeds. Give me the ability to do good deeds, O Allah. Deeds that will please you. And O Allah, grant me entry into the circle of worshippers of yours who are the pious. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us piety. May Allah grant us goodness. This dua is very, very amazing because it is not asking Allah for something more than it is asking for the ability to do something. So I'm not saying, "Oh Allah, I thank you. Oh Allah, give me the ability to thank you." Truly, why? The reason is lip service is simple. Do you really mean what you say? Well, if Allah has granted you the ability to show gratitude properly, you will definitely be able to follow that with the good behavior, the good deeds, and so much more that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that goodness and contentment. Ameen. Now, the contentment of the hereafter will be achieved by those who do good deeds and protect those good deeds. What is meant by protecting good deeds? When you do a good deed, Shaitan will come to you and make you think, "I'm a big deal. I did a lot of salah. I did a lot of good deeds. These people have done nothing." And you know what? You start talking about others in a negative way. You abuse people. You start thinking that they're nothing. What happened to your good deed? It was wiped out. It was given to someone else. When you come on the day of judgment, where is your good deed? Not there. It's already given to someone else. Subhanallah. So this is why Allah warns us at the end of Surah An-Naml, and in various other places of the Quran. If you want the calmness of the Day of Judgment, and if you want that contentment of the Day of Judgment, Allah says,
مَن جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ خَيْرٌ مِّنْهَا وَهُمْ مِّنْ فَزَعٍ يَوْمَئِذٍ آمِنُونَ.
Verse number 89 of Surah An-Naml. Allah says, whoever comes with a good deed, so you haven't lost the good deeds, you've protected them. You did them and then you protected them. And it's 10 times perhaps more difficult to protect it than to do it. For me to fulfill salah, alhamdulillah, I've done it. But for me to watch out for the rest of my life that salah doesn't go to someone else is very, very difficult. Allah says, when you've come on the day of judgment with a good deed, we'll multiply it by 10. Because you were able to come with it. And you know what? Allah says, those people are the ones who will be saved from the huge torment of the day, from the shaking of the day, from the shock of the day, the faza of that particular day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. To protect yourself, you need to make sure that you don't harm others. You need to make sure that the good deeds don't make you arrogant. They don't make you haughty and proud. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us good deeds that are acceptable. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala issues such warnings to mankind to say, you know what, you're looking for contentment, look in the right place. We move on to Surah Al-Qasas, where the story of Musa alayhi salam is mentioned, and this name, Qasas, the stories, named after the story of Musa alayhi salam when he went to Shu'aib alayhi salam after he was chased out of the place he was at, and he got to Shu'aib alayhi salam, and you know what? He says to Shu'aib alayhi salam what happened to him. He helped the daughters, and he walked with them to the house. They came to call him because they narrated that story to the father. That is the Qasas. Subhanallah, those stories. Guess what the father does? He saw a good man. First time meeting him, he heard a good word. He knew he had two daughters. He says, what about marrying one of my daughters? Subhanallah. Would we do that? Subhanallah. You see a good man and you propose to the man directly. There's no harm to speak directly to your son-in-law-to-be, to offer him your daughter. It has happened by those better than you, and it is no harm for him to come to you. In Islam, we believe that the proposal is made by either party, meaning to express the willingness or to express the desire to marry can come from any party. And it's either a yes or a no. We shouldn't be upset if it's a no, and just as much, we should be very, very concerned if it is a yes to fulfill the rights of the spouse to be and all these new relatives that are suddenly related to you. Subhanallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us this in an amazing way. It's a lesson for us to this day. Many of us are not prepared to follow this example. That's why we lose sleep in our homes. Our children are not happy with us. We're not happy. When we are married, we're not happy with our spouses because we end up marrying people we didn't want to marry, and divorce happens, and so much happens because we are complicating things. Make it simple, keep it simple. You will achieve contentment and happiness. Those around you will be happy with the way you handled things. Allah has taught you never to worry about what people think of you and what you're doing, for as long as it is correct, for as long as Allah is pleased with it and Allah allows it, you can do it. And you should. Lead the way. Others will follow you. Lead the way. Those who you were worried about will actually learn from your example. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Qasas, verse number 27. Please go and read this verse and read the story. Allah says,
قَالَ إِنِّي أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُنْكِحَكَ إِحْدَى بْنَتَيَّ هَاتَيْنِ عَلَىٰ أَنْ تَأْجُرَنِي ثَمَانِيَ حِجَجٍ.
This man tells Musa alayhi salam, he tells the Prophet Moses, that you know what? I want to get you married to any one of my two daughters for as long as you're going to work for me for 8 years. You're such a good man, strong, hardworking, and honest. I'm looking for honesty and one who's working hard. If you're honest, you have a good relationship with Allah. You work hard, it's a sign of your good character and conduct. My brothers and sisters, look at how he says one of the two of my daughters. With us, just imagine a person coming to propose for a person coming to propose, and suddenly they're proposing for one who you were not yet expecting. We have a problem. In our communities and societies, we have a false notion and a very dangerous belief that the oldest must marry first. If Allah has written sustenance for one, you do not block it until the other one gets. Maybe Allah has not written sustenance for them. Why don't you try the same with money and say, the person, the second in the family, is not allowed to have a job until the first has a job. Would you do that? No, because it's sustenance. For your information, marriage is also sustenance from Allah. When you ask for rizq, you are asking for a wife or a husband as well. Subhanallah. May Allah grant us ease. So we lose contentment in the home because the second son or daughter or the third or the fourth in line wants to get married, and the others or some of them are not yet married, and we want to apply our own rule, which takes away contentment rather than the rule that brings about contentment. That's why we don't have contentment. Do you have that problem in your home? If the answer is yes, you know how to sort it out. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. My brothers and sisters, we're looking for contentment. Make sure we do it properly. Nikah is something that is so simple, yet we make it difficult. The more difficult you make it, the less contentment you will have. The easier you make it, the more you have guaranteed your contentment, short term and long term. Your children are happy, you are happy, everyone is happy. And keep it simple. Don't get complicated when it comes to marriage. Don't make it too big. Listen to this beautiful verse. He is telling Musa alayhi salam directly. The parents are not involved. He didn't say, where's your father and your mother and so on. Ideally, it would be that we should involve the families, but not every circumstance is ideal. Here is a man, he's come himself to a far off land. He is there in need of something. He just made a dua to Allah. Oh Allah, I'm in need of whatever goodness comes in my direction. And suddenly Allah sends the biggest blessing. What's it? You're just about to get married. Me? Wow. The man just knows a few things about you, but he knows you're a good man. He says, don't worry, I offer you one of my two daughters. Would you ever offer someone, take one of my two daughters? The answer is, do you think I'm so cheap? Not at all, you're not cheap. The people who are more valuable than you in the eyes of Allah have already done it. Who do you think you are? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. May Allah open our doors. There are a lot of lessons that we should learn from this beautiful discussion. And Musa alayhi salam worked for his father-in-law. Today it is taboo in a lot of communities to work for your father-in-law. Never mind work, to live with him is a problem. People look at you and start laughing. There is nothing wrong. For as long as you're happy, forget about the world. You're content, no problem. You could work for him for 8 years, for 10 years. You could take over his businesses at some stage. Nothing wrong, for as long as it was done correctly in an upright way. Allah will open your doors. And this man was married and he became so happy, and he is the messenger of Allah. And for your information, even the other man was a messenger of Allah. These best have gone through this, and the story is mentioned for you and I to learn lessons from. Sort the problems out within your families, and it's very easy to do that. It requires for you to be a man. Stand up for your daughters, stand up for your children, and Allah will grant you contentment, insha'Allah. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا
الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب